Argonus places the ladder against the rocky cliff before driving the legs into the wet sand. Heavy ropes bind the rungs of this statue appears to be under construction. Considering the dire circumstances, it may remain so indefinitely. A strong westerly wind beats against this windmill, moving the light wooden blades in an endless cycle.
Thank you.
The harpies do not appear to view a single sword-wielding historian as a potential threat. The harpies do not appear to view a single sword-wielding historian as a potential threat. Sword raised, Argonus calls upon Hera, praying the great goddess will reveal herself. The mother of Ares obliges the sailor when the statue slowly comes to life and stone lips part.
Argonus,
she says,
stand where you are and move no closer, for you are on holy ground. I have watched you from afar. I have seen your mettle. I have felt your anguish. Did you know that the gods feel anguish as well? Perhaps not for fallen comrades, but certainly for that which has been taken from us. Zeus's pets have taken to roost, defiling my golden orchard, which now lies fallow. I need but one warrior who would reclaim it. Reclaim my honor. Would the name of Argonus be immortalized thus?
Argonus says nothing and raises his sword once again. Hera nods even as the sailor feels her eyes move from his face to his chest, and then finally resting upon his weapon.
But this sword is ill-suited for such a task. Its blade is dulled, but I will grind it fine. Its tip broken. I will make it like new.
Hera transforms the weapon, reshaping the steel with nothing more than a wave of her hand. As Argonus marvels at the restored sword, Hera reverts to stone, but not before a final warning.
Prove yourself, sailor of the Argo, and you shall be rewarded. Fail in this, and not even Athena can save you.
The harpies do not appear to view a single sword-wielding historian as a potential threat. The harpies do not appear to view a single sword-wielding historian as a potential threat. The statue does not move, nor does Hera appear within it. The owl cocks its head, as if listening. is Aegonus, whose lyre charmed stubborn rocks upon the mountains and the course of rivers. Having endured sore afflictions and beached ships, 'tis sad to see Arius, son of Bias and brother of Teleos, in such a state. This cart is in fine shape, and only in need of an ox or horse.
Whatever has passed, and whatever lies before me, I shall never forget the commission laid upon my shoulders by the Queen of the Gods herself. The marvel of Hera's appearance alone would have rendered this simple man dumbstruck, if not for the tales told to me by trusted Argonauts. For I have sailed with men who consorted with gods long before my sandaled foot touched bewitched sand. They have set tall sails on dark rising swells that no other ship has traversed. They have gazed over wooden bulwarks at impossible sights and have seen the dust of vast armies hide the sun. Under starry skies I stood, beneath hero Jason's shadow, listening to their stories, fashioning maps of isles that guarded primordial treasures. Archiving grand quests steeped in truth and bound for legend. Tales to rival those told in the halls of my fathers. But those things are beyond me now. Mighty Argo rests forever upon a strange shore, her keel shattered, her memories carried aloft by dark waves, and lost to boundless waters. Enough, for today is ripe with troubles of its own. If the gods wish to make themselves known to a simple sailor, to call upon me with great labors, I shall be at the ready and face them as my brothers did, as an Argonaut.
Whether the golden skin of these apples was transmuted or grew as such is just one of the many mysteries upon this isle. Argonaut reaches for the golden apple, but a monstrous hiss from above stays his hand. The harpies do not appear to view a single sword-wielding historian as a potential threat. Argonaut reaches for the golden apple, but a monstrous hiss from above stays his hand.